implementing a big data, looking at for a processing, the big data application, whether it's Adobe or some of the advanced tools, the entire that particular tools ported onto infrastructure as a service, using this infrastructure as a service, I'm talking about virtualized server available on the demand, on the fly, with the elasticity how much over the computing power or a memory power or a storage power that you need. So even a processing time, you need more memory. So when you implement Innos, you can add memory once at a time, maybe second at a time. But when you go for a cloud, you can increase it as and when the application demand on the demand resource provisioning by a SL portal or the application demands when the memory can be added. So whether a server, whether infrastructure as a service, including the storage, the memory, the computing power, all the things along with the big data application, whether Adobe or any other application, it uses the cloud.
So you,
from a cloud perspective, it's infrastructure as a service. Even there are recently, for example, my friend is going to talk about Amazon has come out a service called the big data as a service. Am I right? Yeah. So big data as a service being offered by a cloud service provider, which helps instead of investing on a big data analytics software on your own, how to use as a service and pay only for the service that you use, whether for a processing and producing the meaningful data, whether visualization or the whatever the data. So those in globally, many other telcos also implemented. We are also looking at how to implement such kind of the big data as a service. But right now, platform as a service or the infrastructure as a service or a software as a service kind of thing is available.
Thank you.
Thanks for the time. Hope you enjoyed the session.
Well, many thanks, Mr. Manikam. That was a wonderful session. We'll be moving over to our next topic that's going to be covered by Mr. Ganesh Raja, who is working at Amazon as a solutions architect, after which we break for lunch after precisely 40 minutes.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Ganesh. I'm a solutions architect with Amazon. I concentrate on the big data space in Amazon. So I'm here to talk about real-time analytics for big data. So before we get into real-time analytics for big data, I want a raise of hands. How many of you are using AWS today? One. Okay, I'm going to rephrase the question. How many of you know AWS? That's better. Great. So I'll be touching a lot of services, and as I go through the services that we offer and how we help you to do real-time analysis, I will also talk about the salient features of those services and how you can use them. So before we get into real-time analysis, let us figure out what is big data. So when I ask somebody what is big data in a conference like this, one of the audience got up and told, when I do a ls-l on my directory, when I do a directory listing on my directory and the light starts flickering, that is big data. Okay? That's not a great definition, right? So point of this definition, when a data set becomes large enough that you have to innovate to collect, store, organize, analyze, and share the data again, it becomes big data. So big data essentially shows three characteristics. It has velocity, the speed at which the data comes in. It has volume, the amount of data coming in, and the variety of data coming in. So I have data that is structured and unstructured. Or I can only have structured data or only have unstructured data. It doesn't matter. If I have data coming from variety of sources, it is still big data. If I have a lot of volume that I have to innovate to do the five things above, then it is big data. So no big data talk, in my opinion, goes without this slide. This slide is like the holy grail for big data. The volume of data that we will be processing in the coming years. We were doing GBs of data. Now I would say we are doing PBs of data, we have gone past the terabytes of data, we have gone to petabytes, we are going to come to exabytes and zettabytes very soon. By end of next year, most probably we will be in the exabytes range. And I am sure a lot of companies are already on the exabyte range. Your data is not only what your customer is doing, your data can also include web server logs. Your web server logs is your data. Clickstream is your data. Your weather, sensor data. So Manikam gave a great talk on how sensor data is being utilized for big data. So sensor data is big data. So weather data, your devices are sending you data. The Internet of Things, that is sending you data. And that data is very important for you. And I don't have to mention social media, right? So everybody knows the tweets of the world, the Facebooks and Discuss. We've got multitude of things. And that's also going to increase, and it is constantly increasing. So we are going to have data that cannot be managed. So we'll have to start innovating on thinking out of the box to analyze this data, collect this data, store the data. So there's no shortage of big data processing solutions today. So you did have a lot of people talking about during the panel discussions also about Hadoop. You had people talking earlier in the talk about Hadoop. So we have multitude of methods to do big data processing solutions. So the common big data processing approaches are a query engine approach. So you do a SQL or a NoSQL, you pump your data through the database, into the database, and then start querying your data out of the database. You can do repeated queries, multitude of queries you can do. You can do the repeated queries again and again, and get different sets of data, look at different dimensions of the same data. The other thing you can do is you can do something called pre-computations. You must be doing all this today. You must be doing creating materialized views in Oracle, or we call them data views. You pre-compute data and store it in a view, and then you query out of that view. Pre-computed data querying. The other approach is batch engine. Semi-structured data is processed every 1 hour. I give data every 1 hour to the system and ask them to process it. It processes it. There is no pre-computation here. This processing can lead to a database, and then I can store it in the database and pull it out. Or I can continue to have it on my semi-structured format and keep querying it using big data solutions. So MapReduce was a great paradigm shift in the way we were processing data. Instead of getting these huge boxes and asking them to process our data, we decided that we will go towards a solution which will allow us to use commodity hardware. I buy commodity servers. I use laptops and desktops in my office to do processing. I split my data. I give it to multiple processes to process it. A single process manages that, so that all my slaves are doing its work properly. It whips the slave to get the work done. Once the work is done, we push it back into another store or visualize the data. So again, coming back to the big data definition, you're collecting it, you're storing it, you're analyzing it, you need to visualize it also. And one of the presentations in the morning went into great depths about how to visualize and what insights you can gain from visualizing the data. Visualizing of data is very important if you want to get insights into the data. So we are doing all this, right? You're doing batch processing. We are doing aggregated queries. We are doing querying. Why do I need to do real-time processing? First of all, what is real-time processing? Why do I need it at all? So the earlier approaches, if you look at it, they were all having a time lag to it. I query my database for data from the previous day. I query my semi-structured data for data that is 1 hour old or 2 hours old, which comes into my storage. I query my run a Hadoop job on top of it and query the data out to visualize it or analyze it. with real-time processing, I would like to do it now. What is happening now? I don't want to know what happened 1 hour back. I don't want to know what happened yesterday. Again, real-time means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. So if you go and ask a trader in the stock exchange, telling him, hey, what is real-time for you? He will say, less than a millisecond. That is real-time for him. But for us, who are looking at big data, who are looking at a more bigger subset of your data and trying to analyze it, real-time usually comes in the tune of seconds. We don't want to get into the minute level, but we want to keep it to the second level. So it comes into the tune of seconds. So when we were building our platform, right, our AWS, Amazon Web Services platform, we had unique challenges that customers posed to us. They were like asking us different things. And these things motivated us to do real-time processing. We wanted to do real-time processing because our customers forced us to do real-time processing. So let us look at a few of the experiences we have had. We run hundreds and thousands of servers in our data centers. We had to collect these logs, and the customers were asking, how is my server performing now? I don't want to know how my server performed an hour back. I don't want to know whether I had a CPU spike 30 minutes back. I would like to know whether I have a CPU spike now in the system. At a 1 minute granular interval, am I having a CPU spike? And my server log is a big data. Hundreds of thousands of servers sending me data every second on CPU utilization, on memory utilization, on I/O utilization. That is big data for me. Bills. Customers told, hey, your bills are great. You're giving me a bill end of the month. Wonderful. I'm getting a bill, $1,000 at the end of the month. But I would like to know upfront and put a cap on a customer who is trying to run the bill, run AWS, and say, if you cross $500, you alert somebody. So that at the end of the month, I don't get a shock that I've got a $1,000 bill. So that I know that this customer, this particular employee has used beyond his cap. Weekly, monthly billing, metering data, meter, my meter data is big data for me. The number of customers we have, hundreds of thousands of customers in over 190 countries around the world, giving us metering data is big data for me. I need to process it in real time so that I can send an email or a notification to my end customer saying, hey, you have crossed the billing limit. Website clickstream report. My customer goes to product A, the page of product A, via product X, product Y, and product Z. Does it make sense for me to send him to product A directly? Can I make recommendations more instantaneous? Can I send data to process data so that I can give him recommendations based on what product he has been seeing now? Instead of sending him a recommendation maybe 1 hour later or maybe the next time he logs in, I want to show him now what is recommended to him, what he should look at, what he should buy. And conversions are things that is going to help me deliver this. I'm going to take a use case that is not mentioned in this. How many of you use an Android phone here? How many of you know there's something called google.com/location_history? So your Android phone is actually collecting information on every minute, where you are, what you are doing, how fast you are walking, are you running, are you cycling? It collects these information. and stores it and shows it to you, visualizes it for you, actually. Visualizes for you in location underscore history, their page called location underscore history. If you have ever used Google Maps for navigation, today they are able to show you traffic patterns in Bangalore city. Unfortunately, the entire map is covered in red. That's immaterial, but still we are able to see traffic patterns. So showing traffic patterns, I need real-time analytics. That is big data for me. I am collecting information from every Android phone in Bangalore and sending it to a server and then saying, okay, this particular Android phone has been stationary for 10 minutes at this place, and 10 other Android phones around that area are also stationary. That means there is a traffic block and I need to mark it as red. I cannot mark it as green. So if I mark it as red, my other user who is an Android phone user will avoid that road when he navigates. If I show the same information 30 minutes later, is it useful for anybody? No. I need to show it now. Real-time processing. Customers have realized that they need real-time processing. They don't want to look at stale information at all. Everybody wants to look at real-time data. So, the customer's view of real-time data is very, very different. Very different. So, he wants to drive overall latencies to a few seconds compared to minutes and typical batch processing. So, what does he need from a service? He needs a low end-to-end latency. He wants to scale up data ingestion. In real-time systems, the biggest challenge is not processing the data. The biggest challenge is bringing the data into the system. How fast can you bring the data? I have 100 users sending me location information or 100 devices sending me sensor information. Tomorrow, those 100 devices will become 100,000 devices. It will become a million devices or 10 million devices. I should be able to scale seamlessly when needed. I want it to be highly scalable and durable. Now, I have 100 users. Tomorrow, I become 100,000 users. I may become 100 users again. It's business, right? Anything that goes up has to come down, gravity. I cannot keep going up. So, if my business takes a slide, I should be able to scale down as well. I don't want to keep having a huge infrastructure running the size of this room, managing 1 million devices sending me sensory data. I want to be able to bring it down to a pillar, bring it down to the stage, and use only that for 100 or 1,000 devices that are going to use it. There's a lot of complexity involved in streaming data. I would like that to be kept away from me. I don't want to know about that. All I need to know is my device can send data to the stream, and somebody from my side can take that data and process it. I don't want to know how you do it internally. We also need to give a managed service for streaming data. So, end of the day, they need a managed service. The customer needs a managed service. The customer doesn't want to look at, hey, okay, I'm going to do this entire plumbing. I'm going to develop this whole service that is going to do this for me. And how am I going to take it up off or how am I going to scale it? I need to reinvent or innovate there. I don't want to do that. So that is the customer's view on real-time analysis. And since these are not available today, people are not ready to do real-time analytics. Small companies are not ready to do it. People with deep pockets are able to do it, and they want to do it. And they are doing it today. But we want the small startups, SMBs, to also benefit by doing real-time analytics. So, we introduced Amazon Kinesis. It's a managed service for real-time big data processing. It's a very simple sync store. I have multiple data sources. The data sources can be your devices, it can be your websites, it can be your Internet of Things, it can be a watch, it can be anything. As long as it is connected to the internet, it can send data into Kinesis. We store this data for 24 hours in Kinesis. Real time, right? I don't want to keep it more than 24 hours. Then it becomes stale data for me. I keep it in Kinesis for 24 hours. And I expect you to use Kinesis client libraries to do processing on the data. I may want to do aggregation and deduplication and store it in S3. S3 is our simple storage service, which comes with 11 nines of durability. And it's an object store. I can have objects up to 5 terabytes in size. So I may want to aggregate, deduplicate, and put it in S3. I may want to extract metrics. How many times has this particular sensor sent me data? And put it in DynamoDB. DynamoDB is a highly scalable NoSQL database with no maintenance, zero maintenance NoSQL database provided by AWS. I want to do sliding window analytics. As my day progresses, I want to do analytics on it. I want to extract the data, put it in Redshift, and ask my people to do analysis on it. Last 7 days, how was my clickstream data? So what URLs was clicked the most? Sliding window. After 7 days, I throw the data and get another 7 days of data. I only look at 7 days of data every time. Want to do machine learning. I would want to take that stream of data coming in to Kinesis, push it back to Kinesis so that somebody else can do it. I can do some amount of transformation to the data and push it back to Kinesis so that another device can take it out and learn from it.